Gospel according to Mark, the 6th chapter. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask of me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved. Yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison and brought his head on the platter and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. The Gospel of the Lord. Some thought he was a prophet. Some thought he was, in fact, a particular prophet, Elijah, who had been caught up into heaven in a whirlwind and so was not considered to have died. But others, including Herod, thought that Jesus might be John the Baptist, risen from the dead. And so we hear the story of how John came to die. It is a story most of us are familiar with. Herod has John arrested because he has spoken against Herod's marriage to his brother's wife, Herodias. But Herod still respected John, and so didn't kill him as his wife would have wanted. But at Herod's birthday party, Herodias' daughter, who is also named Herodias, pleased Herod so much that he offered her anything, even half of his kingdom. With her mother's influence, she asks for the head of John the Baptist. Now, as I was preparing this sermon, I came across the following story. There were two brothers living in Georgia during the 1950s. One brother decided that despite the dominant culture of that place and that time, he was going to support and participate in a multiracial community. The other brother worked as an attorney for a prominent law firm. Both were Christians and attended church regularly. As the multiracial community formed and grew, social pressure forced them into various court proceedings. And the brother from the multiracial community asked his attorney brother to help them with their legal work. The brother refused, saying that he could lose his job. The one brother continued to pressure his attorney brother for help with a reminder that he was a Christian. The lawyer brother responded, "I will follow Jesus to his cross, but it is his cross. I have no need to be crucified." To this, his brother replied, "Then you are an admirer of Jesus, but not his disciple." This seems like a fitting description of Herod in this morning's gospel. An admirer of John the Baptist, even believing him to be a righteous and holy man. But like the attorney brother in the illustration I read, there are limits as to how far Herod was willing to go out of admiration. Placed in the awkward situation when his wife's daughter asks for John's head at Herod's birthday feast, Herod gives in rather than losing face in front of his many guests. Herod was king, and he could certainly have told this girl that her request was not reasonable, that when he offered even half of his kingdom, that did not include the taking of life. But Herod chose instead to give in to the social pressure of his promise and of his guests. Christians today often face social pressures. We probably don't face having to behead someone, at least not literally, but we still face pressure from others to give in to society's norms rather than God's. As adults, we may feel pressure to lie or fudge on our business dealings or on our taxes because we think everyone else is doing it, and so to not do so as well puts us at a competitive disadvantage. As students, some might be pressured to help someone cheat on an exam or with the writing of a paper, or to take shortcuts in their own assignments and tests. Youth may feel pressure to join in behavior they know is wrong, whether that be drinking, drugs, bullying, or promiscuity. And whatever our age, we may find ourselves ever so subtly pressured by our peers as we join in gossip and judgments about other people. I know that I have been guilty of that at times. No one said that following Jesus, being a true disciple and not just an admirer, would be easy. The early disciples knew that, being well aware of what had happened to John the Baptist. It is why they would later flee when Jesus is arrested. They were afraid that the same thing would happen to them. And yet eventually, most of them did die for the sake of Jesus Christ. Even today, there are places in our world where it is illegal or at least risky to be a Christian. Christianity Today has reported that church leaders in Nigeria say that Christians in that country are experiencing genocide, as 6,000 people, mostly women and children, have been murdered by the Fulani radicals since January. We are fortunate that here in the United States, our lives and our freedom are not at risk of being taken away because of following Jesus. Yet being a Christian and following Christian values is still counter to our society's culture. It is still a battle, if only within ourselves. And so we must be especially vigilant as we go about our lives, to be sure that we are not sliding into society's way of living rather than Christ's. To do that, we must rely on God's strength to help us in this effort, and rely on God's grace when we fail. I invite you to stand as you are able for our hymn of the day. We are seeing verses 1 through 3 and verse 3.